Right. Well, good evening to our evening this digital seminar organized by we are all I call everyone as a dermatologist consortium, no political nothing, this is a body just for this. And I welcome Dr. Resham Vasani today along with my friends and my seniors along with that. So welcome Dr. Resham. And we offer a formal virtual bouquet to you, and we ask everyone to smell it, whether you can smell it or not. Is it all right?
Yes, absolutely beautiful. Yes,
if you can smell, then you do not have any COVID problem. Thank you very much. Right, yes, Dr. U.S. Agarwal, can you please, Dr. U.S.
I think he's muted, sir.
No, but he can unmute.
Yes. Somebody may have to tell him.
Dr. U.S., can you unmute yourself? I told him.
Yeah, now it's okay.
Yes.
So Dr. U.S., can you please...
Is it okay now?
Yeah, yes.
It's fine now.
Okay. So, good evening, everybody. It is my pleasure to introduce the learned speaker today, Dr. Resham Vasani. She is MD, DNB, FCPS, and DBD. At present, she is consultant dermatologist, Bodhwani Clinic, Bombay, Clinical Research Associate, BJ Body Hospital for Children. She has many achievements. She is an editor, assistant editor in many associations, in many journals, to name few of them. She got DAS Award of Excellence in Dermatology in 2019. She is a assistant editor, IJDBL, IJDD, IJDBL Handbook of the Pediatric Dermatology. She is in the editorial board of the IDOG and IJPD. She is a member of this SID Pediatric Dermatology 2018 and 2019. Member of the IJDBL Academy in 2016 and 17. Winner of the National ALMA MD Gold Medal in 2009, IDB Training Fellowship in Dermatopathology, 14 national and 9 international publications, and 14 chapters. And she received many scholarships, including IESM Munich, ICD Delhi, and Menti under IESD.
Thank you.
So now I welcome Dr. Resham Vasani.
Jyoti Sanatana
Lalit, please give felicitation to Dr. Resham.
Welcome, Dr. Resham, and
thank you so much, sir.
It's our honor and pleasure to felicitate you with this wonderful plaque and trophy, which you thoroughly deserve. And this is on behalf of the PGNR, which is organized, as Dr. Dinesh Mathu told you, by the Dermatological Consortium of India. And now we invite you to speak on your talk.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir.
Our Rajesh Mehta is also joined. Rajesh.
Hello. Good evening, sir.
Yes.
Sir, so should I start sharing my screen?
Yes, please.
Please let me know if it's is it visible now?
Yes,
yes, it is visible. Please.
Yeah. So thank you, Dr. Dinesh Mathur, Dr. Lalit Gupta, Dr. U.S. Agarwal, for the kind invitation and the very, very kind introduction. The topic that I'll be speaking on today is dermatological manifestations of COVID-19. Never before in medicine and in our modern societies has a single topic, namely COVID-19, been so present in the media, the politics, the minds, and the medical journals worldwide. This was a quote by Professor Dan Lipsker in Clinical Dermatology 2020. And the truth of this statement I found when I was starting off my research on this topic before the presentation. And when I entered the terms COVID and skin on Google Scholar, it yielded 938,000 results. The frequency of cutaneous manifestations due to COVID-19 have ranged between 0.2 to
0.4. Can you be a bit louder, please, Resham?
Yes, sir. Definitely, sir. Am I audible now?
You are audible, but a little louder will be appreciable.
Sure. The frequency of dermatological manifestations due to COVID-19 have ranged between 0.2 to 20.4% of the cases. The timing, the causality, and the association with severity is something not known, or it is difficult to ascertain at this point in time. The aim of my presentation is to give you a broad and a visual overview of all that we are seeing in this pandemic. So the cutaneous manifestations of dermatological manifestations in COVID-19 can be divided as those which are induced by the virus, paraviral or epiphenomena, post-COVID phenomena, dermatoses which are induced by drugs caused by which are used in COVID-19, flare of existing dermatoses, dermatosis due to the use of PPE and sanitizers, lockdown side effects, and those due to vaccination. So now let's first go to the cutaneous manifestations which are induced by the virus. Now, as per the study by Galvin Casas et al., they have divided the cutaneous manifestations induced by the virus into inflammatory and vasculopathic. The most common manifestation is morbilliform or a maculopapular exanthem. Now, they have clubbed various presentations into confluent erythematous, maculopapular, or a morbilliform eruption. Then there are vesicular or varicella-like eruptions, and there are urticarial eruptions. Among the vasculopathic eruptions, the most common are the pseudo-chilblains, vasculitis or purpuric lesions, and livido-reticularis or livido-racemosa-like lesions. Now, as I said, they have clubbed together multiple manifestations under the confluent erythematous, maculopapular, or morbilliform eruptions. So it also includes pityriasis rosea-like eruption. It includes erythema multiforme-like eruption, erythema elevatum diutinum-like eruption, and perifollicular eruptions. So what I'll be doing is I'll be presenting cases which have been reported in literature so as to have a visual overview of the situation. So this was a patient who was a 90-year-old woman. This is her picture on day one. We can see that the macules and papules, they are discrete. And this is her picture on day four, where we see that the macules and papules have coalesced together. So this eruption appeared a few days after the start of the COVID-19 symptoms. And the COVID this eruption was associated with a mild severity of COVID, and it was an intermediate severity for this case. Then they have reported erythema multiforme-like eruptions. Even here we see that initially the lesions are discrete and then they coalesce together. So this was an 84-year-old woman who presented with generalized targetoid maculopapillar and confluent rash. It was coinciding with the COVID-19 symptoms. This patient needed hospitalization, and whenever we look at anything which is targetoid, we should rule out drug-induced cause, which was ruled out in this case. This was another patient in the 2.5-month-old child presenting with target lesions. So initially the lesions were more discrete and then the number increased, they became larger. The only history was that the grandfather had COVID recently. The patient did not have any mucosal involvement, did not have any systemic symptoms or URTI. This was my patient, a 26-year-old female, had mild asymptomatic COVID, which was positive for nasopharyngeal PCR. And these lesions, they developed a week post-COVID. Here we can see that the initial lesions were well-defined plaques. These plaques then gradually increased in size. They became annular and there was a peripheral colorative scale. We can see that the lesions were in different stages of evolution. And here we see more of acral involvement. We can see that the lesion is also involving the sole. This was a presentation which has been named by authors as erythema elevatum duodenum-like eruption. So this was a 43-year-old woman and she had erythematous papules on the back of her left hand. And this presentation was coinciding with the COVID-19 symptoms. The COVID-19 was of a mild severity and drug-induced causation was thought to be unlikely. Then there are perifollicular lesions described, as we can see in this picture. 25-year-old man had a perifollicular erythematous rash, which was associated with the COVID-19 symptoms, and the COVID was of a mild severity. So what we have learned about maculopapillar eruptions from literature is that these eruptions, they usually occur after the symptoms of COVID-19 start. Exanthema are possibly resulting from the hematogenous spread of the virus through the cutaneous vascular system and the immunological reaction to those viral particles. The lesions are generalized, they are symmetrical, and they have a centrifugal progression. They are associated with pruritus in most cases. And in addition to the perivascular lymphocytic infiltrate and the neutrophilic infiltrate, which is generally expected in a maculopapillar rash, we also see vascular damage prominently in these cases. This presentation is associated with an intermediate severity of COVID. The mean length is around 8.6 days. If the lesions are mild, it would suffice just a topical steroid. But if it is severe, one may need to give oral steroids. Then let's go on to the urticarial eruptions. Now this I would like to exemplify with a case. This was a 2-year-old female child and she had history of urticaria since 5 days. The urticaria was associated with angioedema and it was only partially responsive to hydroxyzine in the age and the weight dependent dose. On the 5th day of rash, there was just a single episode of fever. There was no URTI. There was no COVID contact in the family. Now, since it was the COVID pandemic, the early days of the pandemic, the patient had urticaria, patient had a single episode of fever, and did not optimally respond to hydroxyzine. So that is why the patient was investigated. On investigations, there was leukocytosis with lymphopenia. Hence, RT-PCR was advised, which came out to be positive. Fortunately, this patient recovered without complications. Now, this was a second case. He was a 42-year-old male. He was a known case of diabetes since 4 years, and he was on sitagliptin with metformin. Now, he had an angioplasty done 12 days back for which he was admitted, obviously, and he was admitted. And that point in time, his COVID testing was done, which was negative. After angioplasty was done, he was started on Ecosprin, Ticagrelor, Rosuvastatin, and Fenofibrate. Now, he presented with urticated lesions associated with intense itching and burning since the past 5 days. Before coming, the patient already had been to a general practitioner, was receiving 3 kinds of antihistamines, but there was no response, and the patient did not have any other systemic symptoms apart from the urticarial lesions. This was an urticated edematous plaque on the lower back. He also had involvement of the palm. There were multiple urticated lesions on the upper limb. And there was involvement of the sole. Now, as per the history, the patient said that these urticated lesions lasted for more than 24 hours. The lesions were associated with severe burning rather than itching. There was associated swelling of the foot, and there was pain, which was making it difficult for the patient to walk. So considering this history, I thought of urticarial vasculitis as the diagnosis, and hence investigated the patient. Now, urticarial vasculitis in this case could have might as well been because of the new drugs that he had been started on, that is Ecosprin, Ticagrelor, Rosuvastatin, Fenofibrate. But considering the COVID situation, we further investigated the patient. So his hemoglobin was normal, the WBC was normal, but there was relative lymphopenia. The CRP was quite high, which was 48. He was uncontrolled diabetic, so his glucose was positive in the urine. ANA was negative. The complement levels were almost normal. RT-PCR for COVID-19 was advised to the patient but did not do it, saying that we have done it 12 days back on before getting admitted for angioplasty. Now, the biopsy was done. The biopsy showed the presence of vasculitis involving the small vessels. And as we can see, there was a diffuse interstitial infiltrate of multiple neutrophils and eosinophils, and there was presence of nuclear dust. We can see the presence of fibrin deposition around the vessel wall with the presence of neutrophils and nuclear dust. So this diagnosis was confirmed as urticarial vasculitis. Now, this patient was continued on the antihistamine, was started on dapsone 50 mg HS. Now, the patient did not respond to dapsone. After 48 hours, tablet colchicine 0.5 milligram was added. Initially, two times in a day, patient still did not respond. Hence, the dose was increased to 0.5 milligram three times in a day. The patient had intense pain, swelling, and difficulty in walking. So that is why tablet intomethazine was added twice daily. Now, with this prescription, the patient was much better. The new lesions stopped appearing after 10 to 12 days, and he was continued on the medications that he was already on. Now, 12 days later, he gives me a call saying that I want to get the vaccination for COVID-19. So should I be getting it? So now I insisted that most likely what you have suffered is urticarial vasculitis because of COVID-19. So before you go for a vaccination, please get the antibody titer done. And the antibody titer came out to be positive. And this was done on day 14 after starting treatment. So this was a case where urticarial vasculitis was the only presentation of COVID-19. So what we learn about urticaria in COVID-19 is the incidence is around 19%. There can be acral lesions, truncal or generalized lesions, which can be associated with angioedema. The urticarial eruptions can occur before or after the COVID symptoms. It may reflect the combination of the angiotensin converting 2 enzyme, which is the receptor for COVID-19, causes complement activation, which further causes direct stimulation of the mast cell degranulation, leading to the liberation of histamine and the consequent symptoms. Whenever we see clustering, like multiple patients in the family having urticarial symptoms, one should think of COVID-19. In addition to the regular perivascular infiltrate and dermal edema, which we see in the urticaria, regular urticaria, they have also demonstrated vacuolar interface dermatitis with the presence of necrotic keratinocytes in the histopathology of urticaria associated with COVID-19. The COVID-19 that's associated with urticaria is usually of an intermediate severity, the mean length being 6.8 days. And two cases of urticarial vasculitis have also been reported. Then there are varicella-like or vesicular eruptions which have been reported. So what we know about it is that it's not very common. The incidence is 9%. The mean age is 45 to 60 years. There is a mean delay after symptoms of COVID for this eruption to appear. The mean delay can be 3 to 14 days, but sometimes it can also precede COVID symptoms by 48 hours. It is necessary to differentiate it from varicella. So there are certain pointers, like one, the lesions are very scattered. The lesions are not polymorphous like what we expect in varicella. And itching is a complaint which possibly we don't see in varicella very commonly as is seen in COVID-19. The median length is 8 to 10 days. On histopathology, there is ballooning and reticular degeneration leading to acantholysis and the presence of multinucleated giant cells. So this is something that one would expect with herpes viruses. So also the skin PCR has been found to be negative in such cases. So we are really not sure whether this presentation is primarily due to COVID or is it because of the reactivation that can happen with the herpes viruses. This is associated again with intermediate severity of COVID-19. Now let's go on to the vasculopathic manifestations. Pseudochilblains have been reported. So what are pseudochilblains? They look like this. They are erythematous. They are violaceous purpuric patches and swellings with involvement of the periungual and the subungual skin. There can be at times vesiculobullous or crusted lesions, and there is usually a clear demarcation which is seen at the metatarsophalangeal level. This presentation of pseudochilblains is more common in the younger individuals and in adolescents, but it has also been reported in a 50-year-old diabetic COVID-positive female who presented with pseudochilblains since 15 days, and this was associated with a very mild severity of COVID. Now, this presentation has been famous on social media as COVID toes. But what we need to remember is that this can also be seen on the fingers. So what we need to know about pseudochilblains is this is a more common presentation in the younger age group. It involves the toes and less frequently both the fingers and the toes. It's a delayed manifestation. The delay is on an average 3 to 30 days post-COVID. It is considered secondary to a delayed immune-mediated response involving the small cutaneous capillaries. In general, the patient has excellent health and there are mild or no symptoms of COVID at all in most of these patients. On histopathology, they have demonstrated prominent vascular damage. In fact, there has been a cluster of cases where they have demonstrated endothelitis. Endothelitis, and they have also demonstrated the SARS-CoV-2 virus within the endothelial cells. So, the nasopharyngeal PCR intriguingly has been found to be negative in these cases. So what literature mentions as an explanation as to why the nasopharyngeal PCR is negative is because this presentation is very late. It happens post-COVID symptoms, so or no symptoms at all, right? So by the time the patient develops these pseudochilblains, the PCR comes out to be negative. Also, the blood serologies are found to be negative. Now, the explanation as to why the blood serologies are negative is because these patients have demonstrated a very good type 1 interferon alpha response. So now this interferon alpha, it's an antiviral. So they say that before the body can mount an immune response, the virus is killed. And that is why these patients have a very good prognosis and they are associated with only mild or no symptoms of COVID. Another explanation is that when we do an anti-SARS COVID antibody, we usually do the IgM and the IgG antibody. But in these cases, they have found that it is an IgA response, which we do not usually get it done because that is done in very specific laboratories. So possibly that's why we end up getting the blood serology to be negative. As I mentioned, the outcome of these cases is excellent with recovery within 4 to 8 weeks. Hence, considering this scenario, the link between pseudochilblains is yet unproven, but is definitely likely because there were a number of these patients who presented in 2020, especially in the summer. Like we would explain chilblains in winter, but this cohort presented in summer. Then there are livedo reticularis like lesions. So what is livedo reticularis? These are regular lace like network of non-fixed dusky patches forming complete rings. And this happens in COVID because there is a low grade vasculer inflammation and vasodilatation, which is caused by the direct SARS-CoV-2 infection of the endothelial cells, as well as of the vessel associated smooth muscle cells. So this presentation of livedo reticularis is associated with intermediate severity of COVID-19. Then let's go to livedo racemosa. Livedo racemosa, in contrast to livedo reticularis, is asymmetrical. It is localized. It's mostly unilateral, irregular, and there are broken rings. They are not complete rings. They are broken rings. And this presentation is associated with a severe COVID-19. There are purpuric eruptions which are reported. Like in this patient, he was a 63-year-old man and had a purpuric eruption with COVID-19 symptoms. He was hospitalized for pneumonia. Then we are also seeing very intriguing vascular phenomena. Like in this patient, he was 37 years old and he complained of fever. On the fourth day of fever, he started with intense burning sensation and pain, as well as swelling of both the palms. And this patient was diagnosed as a case of palmoplantar dysesthesia, erythrodysesthesia, and he responded on his own. Like, there was no specific treatment given. The lesions, they responded on their own with the conservative treatment given for COVID, and it resolved with this kind of acral peeling or fine desquamation. In literature, they have also mentioned acral pigmented macules, which can happen post palmoplantar dysesthesia associated with COVID-19. Now, this is a bar diagram which shows us the various manifestations and most frequency of these manifestations in relation to the stage of COVID. So here we can see that the chilblain-like eruption usually appeared in the post-COVID or the post-acute stage. In the acute stage of COVID, urticarial eruptions, livedoid lesions, varicella-like lesions, they were more commonly seen. This is another beautiful diagram. This was from JAD in the registry, which was put up by Freeman et al. And here we see the correlation of the clinical symptom with the severity of COVID-19. So we can see that perneo-like lesions, they are associated with mild or very low severity of COVID-19. Vesicular, urticarial, macular erythematous and morbilliform eruptions, they are associated with intermediate severity of COVID-19. And retiform purpura, livedo reticularis or livedo racemosa, they are associated with severe COVID-19. Then there are oral manifestations of COVID which have been reported. So these manifestations have been reported in people who were positive for SARS-CoV by nasopharyngeal PCR. So here you can see a geographic tongue. Here you can see an erythematous tongue with superadded candidiasis. One can appreciate here the palatal erythema. Here there is fissuring of the angle of the mouth. So these manifestations are seen in patients who are positive for COVID, but not necessarily these eruptions are caused by the virus. It could be because of the drug eruption. It could be a paraviral eruption or reactivation of herpes, or it could be because of confinement as well. Then there are certain nail manifestations which have been reported with COVID. These manifestations are the transverse red bands of the nail. So these transverse red bands of the nail, they have been specifically referred to as the red half moon nail sign. Okay. And the cause of this particular manifestation is not something known as yet. There are Bose lines, which are expected because this is a lot of physical and mental stress, right? So there is transient arrest in the growth of the nail, which can explain the Bose line, as well as Mies lines can happen because of hypoproteinemia. Then there are cases who were admitted for COVID-19 and there were references given in the ward for these oral lesions. So this was herpes simplex or herpes orolabialis in a COVID positive patient. And this patient responded to a cyclovir. This was another patient having herpes simplex again. This was a patient where this was referred to as a bed sore, but in fact, this patient had herpes simplex and this responded to acyclovir. So herpes definitely can get reactivated not only during COVID-19, but also after COVID-19 as well as post-vaccination. This reactivation can be because of multiple causes. We do not know the exact cause, but it has been reported possibly in relation to the lymphopenia that happens during acute COVID. Also, it can happen because of the immunosuppression that the patient receives during the hospital stay, as well as the stress. Also, we see reactivation of herpes zoster, especially complicated zosters. Like in this patient, she had herpes zoster ophthalmicus. We can very well see the involvement of the tip of the nose, suggesting the involvement of the nasociliary nerve. And she had complicated ocular complication of herpes zoster. This was a patient who had herpes zoster and there were multiple vesicular lesions on the jawline and he landed up with a facial palsy. So this was Ramsay-Hunt syndrome. Also, we are seeing pediatric herpes zoster more frequently in this scenario. Then there are certain anecdotal reports. So they have mentioned periorbital dyschromia as an early sign of COVID-19. Erythema nodosum, this is a reactive phenomenon, has been reported with multiple viruses and so has been reported with COVID-19. Then there are erythema nodosum-like sweet syndrome with concurrent onset with symptoms of COVID-19. Then let's go to the dermatoses which are observed due to drugs given for the COVID-19 infection. So I'll be sticking to the drugs which are currently very frequently given. So one of them is remdesivir. It can cause a maculopapular rash. Tocilizumab can cause maculopapular rash, urticaria. It can even cause cellulitis and necrotizing fasciitis. Cutaneous sarcoidosis has been reported, as well as pustular eruptions can happen post this drug. Steroid-induced acneiform eruptions are quite common because of the rampant use of steroids in this pandemic. Also, this is not a side effect, but an observation where they saw people who had consumed favipravir when their nails, hair, and eyes were examined under the Wood's lamp. It showed fluorescence. So this fluorescence corresponded to the duration for which they took favipravir. Then we know that certain institutes do administer injection sepsivac. This is from Cadila and it is nothing but the Mycobacterium vaccae or the Mycobacterium indicus prani vaccine. So there have been immunological local site reactions to this particular injections and they are very frequently noted nowadays. So the regimen is that this vaccine is given 0.3 ml per day intradermally at three different sites on both the deltoids consecutively for 3 days. So it is seen that 7 to 8 days later, many of these patients develop bright red pustules, which later get converted into small punched out ulcerations. And this was seen on all the 9 sites where this vaccine was administered. So this is nothing but an immunological local site reaction to the Mycobacterium W. And possibly it can also happen if the injection is given subcutaneously rather than it being given intradermally. So most of these lesions can be managed conservatively. Patient can be given anti-inflammatory analgesics and topical steroids. Sometimes it can be of a moderate severity. In that case, they have reported minocycline. It is having anti-inflammatory as well as anti-atopical mycobacterial action. And that's how it works in such cases. In severe cases, when they are not responding to even intralesional steroids, then possibly one may need to administer AKT. Then let's go to the post-acute COVID syndrome. Now, what is this post-acute COVID syndrome? It's a syndrome which is characterized by persistent symptoms and or delayed or long-term complications beyond 4 weeks from the onset of COVID symptoms. So here we need to be aware of multi-system inflammatory syndrome. So basically, this is thought to happen because even after the patient being negative for COVID-19, there can be persistence of the virus in other organs like the nervous system, cardiovascular, gastrointestinal system, and kidneys. And that is possible mechanism for post-COVID multi-system inflammatory syndrome. Also, endothelial inflammation that has happened because of the infection of the endothelial cells by the SARS-CoV-19 virus may lead to thromboinflammatory disease, which also contributes to this presentation. So a Kawasaki-like syndrome where we see non-purulent conjunctivitis, a polymorphous rash, mucosal changes with swollen extremities has been reported. And it has been aptly named as Kawasaki-like inflammatory syndrome, also called as pediatric inflammatory multisystem syndrome, that is PIMS, temporally correlated with the SARS-CoV infection. So it is slightly different from the Kawasaki that we know. Here, the child usually has an older age than what is expected in Kawasaki. More frequent presentation is with gastrointestinal signs because we know that the ACE enzyme is present, the receptor is present in the GI. So here they have GI signs as well as respiratory involvement more frequently than what we expect in the regular Kawasaki that we know. 60.4% of these patients demonstrate myocarditis, while coronary artery involvement is more common in Kawasaki. Not every patient is going to be COVID positive. There may or may not be a history of contact with COVID. COVID positivity is only to the tune of 75% to 5%, if 75.5% in these cases. And the risk of admission in the ICU is much higher in Kawa COVID versus Kawasaki. Also, there have been patients where they have a maculopapular or a targetoid eruption a few days after they have recovered from COVID. So this patient had maculopapular lesions on day 19 after COVID symptoms. There were a few lesions which were targetoid. There were no lesions on the palms and soles. There was no oral involvement. Rash occurred on day 4 after discharge from the hospital. Now, after the presentation, this cutaneous presentation, the patient's CRP and D-dimer was done, which was quite significantly raised. And this patient did not have any other systemic manifestations of COVID-19 and responded to a short course of systemic corticosteroid. But here, this patient may not be MIS, but what we need to remember is that if we see a maculopapular rash in the post-COVID era, if the patient also has associated fever, associated raised lab evidence of severe inflammation like elevated CRP, D-dimer, interleukin 6, we should keep in mind that it can be a possible case of multi-system inflammatory syndrome, which now is being increasingly reported in adults. So these patients can have severe dysfunction of one or more extra pulmonary organ systems, like there can be hypotension, shock, cardiac dysfunction, arterial or venous thrombosis, liver injury, conjunctivitis, as well as the cutaneous manifestation can be a diffuse maculopapular rash. So the message is that if we do encounter rashes in the post-COVID era, one should screen the patient thoroughly to rule out any kind of a multi-system inflammatory syndrome. Then a very intriguing phenomenon we are now observing is post-COVID, we see relapse or new onset autoimmune disorders. A possible explanation is that there are immunological aberrations and inflammatory damage which happens in response to the acute infection with COVID. So I would just like to exemplify with a few cases. This was a patient who had history of alopecia areata, which was quite focal 2 years back. And he had responded to intralesional steroids at that point in time. Now, very recently, he got admitted for COVID-19. He had severe COVID. He was in the hospital for 20 days with CNS complications. He completely recovered from COVID. And 10 days post the recovery, he presented with severe diffuse hair loss and had a very strong hair pull test. So on dermoscopy, this patient was diagnosed as having diffuse reticular variant of alopecia areata. And when I examined his nails, the patient also had Mürke's lines. So this patient was given a short course of a steroid for a month. Along with it, he was given protein supplementation, was given iron, and he completely recovered. So this was a relapse of alopecia areata post-COVID. Then this was another patient. She was a 31-year-old female. And the only symptomatology she had for COVID was that she had lost her taste. So she had agusia. Now, as soon as she recovered her taste, she found that she had intense burning sensation in the mouth. So this was around a month post COVID. Now, on examination, there was a bullous lesion which was present on the inner aspect of the lip. Along with it, there was a classical lesion of lichen planus on the hard palate, a classical lesion of lichen planus on the tongue, as well as she had reticulate appearance of oral lichen planus on the buccal mucosa. So this was a patient who had appearance of bullous variant of oral lichen planus post-COVID-19. The patient is currently on HCQS and has been recently started on Dapsone with topical steroids. Now, this patient was having moderate severity of COVID-19. He was hospitalized, received remdesivir and steroids. And 2 months post-COVID had severe urticaria. And this urticaria also presented on the palms and the soles. So a drug-induced etiology was ruled out because it was already 2 months post-COVID. He was not on any specific medications. And this urticaria responded to the updosed version of pilastin. So this was acute onset of urticaria post-COVID-19 as the first symptom. There was no history of urticaria in the past. Now, this was a patient who had COVID-19 2 months back and now presented with a hemorrhagic bulla on the buccal mucosa. He also had purpuric lesions on the upper extremity. So the COVID that he had suffered from was very mild and he was just home quarantined. But now with this symptom, he was investigated and his platelet count was dropped to 70,000. He was immediately admitted. He was given platelets as well as given steroids. And this patient was diagnosed as post-COVID immune thrombocytopenic purpura. This was another similar patient, was admitted earlier, had received low molecular weight heparin on the abdomen. But at that point in time, he never had any kind of ekymotic patches. But post-COVID, a month later, he had an ekymotic patch on the abdomen, was investigated, was found to have thrombocytopenia. And again, he was diagnosed as post-COVID thrombocytopenia presenting as an ekymotic patch. So, in addition, what we are now encountering are post-COVID prothrombotic phenomena. Now, why are we possibly encountering this? The possible explanation is that there is endothelial dysfunction, which is persisting post-cytotoxic effects of the SARS-CoV-2 infection and overactive immune response, which is causing prolonged vasculitis. This leads to breach of the endothelial barrier integrity, exposing the tissue factors and procoagulant cytokines from the underlying vessels, triggering the tissue factor-driven secondary homeostasis. So this was a patient, a 57-year-old male presenting with dry gangrene. He was post-COVID 2 months. The Doppler was suggestive of thrombosis of the right axillary and right branchial artery. And there was this another patient who was 42-year-old female and she presented with painful discoloration of the fingers. The Doppler studies were showing left-sided radial, ulnar and digital arteries showing low velocity monophasic flow due to thrombosis. So this was unilateral arterial thrombosis, which was post-COVID. This was another patient, a 65-year-old male. He was RT-PCR for COVID-19 2 months back. And now he developed an extensive purpuric patch on the abdomen. On investigations, his APT as well as APTT was prolonged and there was leukocytosis. He was diagnosed as a post-COVID disseminated intravascular coagulation. So that was about the prothrombotic phenomena that we are seeing post-COVID. Now we move on to the paraviral phenomena. For the PG students here, what is the difference between a virus-induced phenomenon and a paraviral phenomenon? The difference between a classical viral eruption and a paraviral eruption is that the skin lesions result from direct interaction between the virus and the skin in the former, that is in the classical viral eruption, while in a paraviral eruption, it is because of the immune reaction, which is triggered by the virus in the latter. So now, this was a very interesting case. This patient had COVID. A month later, he presented with acute onset of erythematous blanchable papules, which were resembling angiomas. And if you see very closely, these angiomatous lesions, they were surrounded by a halo, a pale halo. So this was nothing but eruptive pseudoangiomatosis, which was a paraviral phenomenon post-COVID-19. This was another patient. She complained of axillary itch. She had recovered from COVID completely 2 months back. And now she presented with these kind of atypical lesions. So this could have been missed by me, because it was bilateral and very atypical. But then on the trunk, she had a few lesions. And these lesions on dermoscopy showed the classical Collarett scale. So this was a patient having atypical pityriasis rosea. We've also seen multiple cases of classical pityriasis rosea occurring 2 months post-COVID. Then this was a patient showing erythema multiforme post-COVID. Along with it, there was intense pruritus. So this was 1 month post-COVID and the patient had severe COVID-19 for which the patient was given remdesivir, low molecular weight heparin and steroids while the patient was hospitalized. He was off steroids for a week before the appearance of this rash. Because of the intensity of the itch and the extensive nature of the eruption, the patient was given steroids again. Then we are also seeing certain post-COVID sequelae. So we are seeing palmoplantar exfoliation. So this patient was detected COVID positive on 9th of May. He was having just mild symptoms. He was diagnosed negative on 17th of May and he presented with diffuse scaling over the palms on 28th of May. He did not have any erythema, did not have any rash prior to the appearance of this exfoliation. So this kind of exfoliation is what we see when there are super antigens involved, but possibly the exfoliation that we see in patients having toxic shock syndrome or in patients having scarlet fever is more, the scales are much larger. These scales are much finer. Then this is a more severe case. Again, this patient had severe generalized pruritus and had severe palmoplantar exfoliation. There was no plausible rash prior to the appearance of these symptoms. I think all of us have seen multiple patients having telogen effluvium, usually presenting 3 months post-COVID. Now, this was another interesting case. 45-year-old male had bilateral pneumonitis due to COVID and he was having these symptoms for a month. He was on a ventilator for 2 days and had received intermittent oxygen for 20 days. He had received steroids as a part of the treatment for COVID. And he was also a known case of diabetes mellitus for 2.5 years. And now he developed an ulceration over the palate. On histopathology, this was the picture and this was the smear, a crush smear. So here we can see there were broad ribbon-like widely septate hyphae, a septate hyphae with wide angles. And this was very, very diagnostic of mucormycosis. Yeah. So now this was a second patient. This patient was diagnosed diabetes when she was admitted for COVID, and she was on a ventilator for a few days as well. And she also received injectable steroids during her hospital stay. Now she presented with bloodstained discharge from one nostril, and there was severe pain on one side of the face. So this patient was diagnosed as mucormycosis. Now there are multiple criteria which have been put forth in 1950, but definitely still hold true. So here the manifestation was blood-stained nasal discharge, facial pain, both on the same side, with a soft periorbital and a perinasal swelling with discoloration and induration. So I think if we do see this kind of a presentation, we should think of mucormycosis in this pandemic. Then there are dermatoses due to PPE and sanitization. Now, through the lockdown, we have been seeing a number of cases who present with this kind of a macerated and a wrinkled look to the hands and the feet. And this is nothing but aquagenic keratoderma of the palms and the soles, which is now reported in an increasing frequency because of the tendency to wash the hands more frequently, which results in increased duration of contact with the water, and there is keratinocyte swelling because of enhanced water holding capacity of the stratum corneum. This is cumulative irritant contact dermatitis present on the dorsa of the hands because of repeated hand washing as well as excessive use of sanitizers. Also, nowadays we are seeing paronychia occurring more commonly in male patients because of the lockdown. No maids, they are also exposed to a lot of wet work and they'll end up with paronychia. This is of course on account of repeated hand washing. Now this was a patient who complained of itching and scaling on the soles. On probing, the patient gave history of repeatedly rubbing the sanitizer on the feet. So this was contact irritant dermatitis on the sole on account of rubbing the sanitizer on the feet. So it's not only the hands, the soles also can be involved. Then this is something that we are encountering, and that is aggravation of acne due to the use of masks. Now, we need to know that this is a kind of an acne mechanica. When we wear a mask, there is local increase in the temperature. This increase in the local temperature also causes increased sebum excretion rate. It also causes more sweating. So there is increased humidity and hydration with irritation of the pilosebaceous duct. And all this is a very good a medium for the Cutibacterium acnes, which multiplies and then it gives rise to inflammatory lesions of acne. Then we are also seeing aggravated rosacea because of the use of masks. This can be explained because of the increased sebum. The Demodex folliculorum has a field day and it multiplies and causes an amplified inflammation with papules, pustules and erythema. Then we are also seeing a lot of aggravation of seborrheic dermatitis. So seborrheic dermatitis is because of the higher temperature which one faces while wearing a mask. There is proliferation of malassezia species. There is also increased permeability of the skin because of the impairment of the barrier, and it causes a kind of an irritant dermatitis in addition to the seborrheic dermatitis. Also, now let's go to the adverse reactions which are reported post-COVID-19 vaccination. I think all of us, whether in practice or in institutes, are facing now these with increasing frequency. We are now seeing morbilliform reactions, urticaria, perineo or chilblain-like lesions, pityriasis rosea, typical, atypical, both are being encountered. Also, we should be aware of an entity which has been named as the COVID arm. So it was initially called as the Moderna arm, but it has also been reported by the after the Pfizer vaccine. So this is a delayed cutaneous reaction which occurs after the first dose of the vaccine, and it's usually delayed by around 7 to 14 days. So you usually see a large localized swelling. There can be skin nodules and even an induration of the skin. Now, when the patient develops this, the patient asks you, can I take the second vaccine? Yes, one has to take the second vaccine. It is expected that the patient will develop this kind of an induration sooner, but it may be less severe. This is not a very major side effect. Just ice application, antihistamines, and topical steroids can solve the problem. Now, this was another patient who had received a filler. This filler was 5 weeks before she got the vaccine. Now, 8 days post the Moderna vaccine, she started developing symptoms of redness, pain, and swelling at the site of the filler. So possibly what happened is that because she took the vaccine, the immune response got generated, and this immunity now recognized that this hyaluronic acid is not something native. This is something foreign, and therefore there was a foreign body kind of a reaction against it. So the treatment of this kind of a reaction is a high dose of corticosteroids. They have also given ACE inhibitors like lisinopril for this condition. And one has to dissolve the filler by giving high dose of intralesional hyaluronidase. So this is a COVID-19 related delayed inflammatory reaction to the hyaluronic acid dermal fillers. Then there has been cases of vaccine-induced thrombocytopenia. So this was an individual who had no other identifiable cause for these kind of petechial lesions. And he was thrombocytopenic when investigated. And this happened 3 days after he received the Pfizer vaccine. There have been instances of erythema multiforme, which has been reported post-vaccination. There was this recent report of a patient who had received Covaxin. And following that, around 4 days post the second dose, the patient developed leukocytoclastic vasculitis. Now, this leukocytoclastic vasculitis was more so asymmetrical. The possible reason the authors have quoted is because the patient used to sit with one leg up and the other leg down, one on the other. Possibly that is the reason the lesions are asymmetrical. And intriguingly, they found that there was eosinophilic predominance when they looked at the histopathology. And we are also seeing the effects of lockdown. So we are seeing that there is exacerbation of existing dermatosis, whether it is psoriasis, whether it is atopic dermatitis, lichen planus, or urticaria. We can think of multiple causes for this: the stress, anxiety of the lockdown, confinement, delay in the diagnosis, delay in the consultation with the concerned doctor, as well as treatment withdrawal are few of the causes which can be thought of for the reasons for these exacerbations. Now, this was a patient, the father, he was around 16 years old. And the father said that I rarely see him because by the time I come back home, his room is locked. He spends around 12 hours on a chair, and he has been doing that all through the lockdown. Now, the cushion of that chair has worn off. And his legs, I mean, these toes, they were brushing against the wooden frame, and that caused these callosities. So this was one of the effects of lockdown. This was another patient. He was a NEET PG aspirant. He has been studying all day very hard, sitting down on the floor. So this was one of the manifestations of his lockdown quarantine. Now, this was a 72-year-old male, and because there were no maids at home, he had to wipe the floors every day. And he used to do that by sitting, in a kneeling on the floor. So as a result of that, he had developed callosities on both the knees. Also, we have encountered certain individuals who are hellbent on completing their 10,000 steps through the day. And unfortunately, they don't wear protective footwear because they are at home, and they end up with these kind of cones. So this is also labeled as a quarantine foot. Also, because of the online schooling, because of the changing lifestyle, there have been a lot of patients complaining of stria rubra. They actually did a study and they compared the incidence of stria rubra, and they found that in the lockdown, they saw that the incidence of stria rubra had increased 4 times. So this was more noted in the younger age group because they are receiving online education. So they are doomed to the sedentary life at home. There is rapid increase in the weight gain because of the changes in the nutrition and lifestyle. And that eventuates in this presentation. Now, this was a phenomenon which was reported by us in the CED. Now, patients, children, they are having online schooling. Their modality of entertainment is also online. So what they do is that they sit with both their hands, with their head on the, their chin is resting on their hands. So that is why they develop this kind of traumatic anserine polyneurosis. Now, this was another child who used to sleep while watching his online studies. And he used to place his hand on the, he used to place the palm on the cheek, and he developed traumatic anserine folliculosis of the cheek. Then in lockdown has been stressful, I think, for all of us. And it has been especially stressful for the elderly. So this patient, through the lockdown, he had developed this habit of constantly picking at his nails. And we can very well appreciate the jagged margin of the nail on onychoscopy. And this was onychotillomania, developed on account of the stress in the lockdown. This was a female patient who was laid down. She was earlier working at a 5-star hotel. And she was laid down, and the stress that she went through the lockdown eventuated in the lichen simplex chronicus of the vulva. So the take-home points at the end of my presentation are that COVID-19 and dermatology is an evolving science. We still do not know a lot of it, but we are learning very, very gradually. Skin lesions can occur before, after, or during COVID-19. As dermatologists, we should know what is happening, we should read about it, and we should suspect it at the right time, investigate the patient at the right time so that we can isolate and refer the patient to the concerned specialty. And with time, I think we can come up to a stage where we can grade the severity of COVID on the basis of a dermatological manifestation. I would not be My presentation will not be complete without acknowledging these people who have been directly or indirectly responsible and helpful in my presentation. And thanks to all the authors who have worked tirelessly, risking their lives in this COVID-19 pandemic. With that, I end my presentation. Thank you very much for a patient listening.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Resham. It was indeed an excellent, super excellent presentation.
Thank you,
sir. Dr. Rajesh, will you formally thank Dr. Resham and see something? Is there in the chat box?
Sir, it's my privilege to just say thanks for a par excellence presentation. She doesn't look like to be a professor, but her presentation was more than professorial as far as text was concerned, the pictures were concerned, and everything around. And it reminds me of Dr. J.K. Maniar, sir. In early era of HIV, he used to tell us that anything damn which is beyond diagnosis, think, open your eyes wide open and think, can it be HIV? So same is true for, I think, COVID, and the history repeats itself. The acute, manageable, immunogenic